Hey friends, welcome on Beyond the Lines. I'm your host, Shilpi Shukla, and we're here to talk about the Tata way of business. Jamshedji Tata started Tata & Sons in the year 1868, and in the following 150 years, the Tata Group has continually risen into becoming India's largest global conglomerate that it is today. This is a fascinating story, and the same has been very well researched and documented by Dr. Shashank Shah in his recent book, The Tata Group, From Torchbearers to Trailblazers. So let's meet Dr. Shashank Shah, who's been a visiting scholar at Harvard Business School and is fellow and project director at Harvard University. Hello, Dr. Shah. Welcome on the show.
Thank you, Shilpi. It's great being here on the show.
Dr. Shah, tell us about yourself and how and when did you decide to pen this book?
My journey on writing about Indian businesses started almost 10 years ago while I was doing my doctoral research. And I have been interviewing several industry captains, subject experts, academic scholars, both in India and overseas ever since. In the last decade or so, I would have interviewed about 250 such subject experts and business captains across India and also in Europe and America. And as I was doing this, I gathered several insights, and over a period of time, I realized that there is so much out there which I can share, especially on Indian businesses, which aren't documented that comprehensively. Most of business writing is commissioned because it's about some autobiographical account or a biographical account or about the story of a company. And all my works aren't commissioned. They are an outcome of my research. So I thought I'll have an opportunity to present frank views from my side. Secondly, we've always been taught in business schools using examples from international companies, global corporations, MNCs. So I thought there is a great learning out here in Indian corporations itself, where our next gen budding managers and business leaders who are currently in our business schools should know about and can learn from. So there I saw a big opportunity to write about Indian businesses, successful corporations. So this is my third book, The Tata Group. The previous two, The Soulful Corporations by Springer and Win-Win Corporations by Penguin, also capture the story of successful Indian corporations. I never planned to write a book on the Tatas, to be frank. But as I was doing all these interviews I just shared with you, I realized that there is so much out there to write about the Tatas, because as you just introduced the book and the group, it's India's largest conglomerate. It has a customer base of over 65 crore customers. Every alternate Indian consumes some Tata product or the other, the most popular being Tata Salt. It has almost 7.2 lakh employees. It's India's largest private sector employer. It's also India's most value creating group in terms of shareholder value creation, the largest market cap on most of the bourses. So, and it is India's most valuable brand at $19.5 billion, the Tata brand, which can be called India's only global brand. So you have all of these superlative characteristics of the Tata Group. And I thought there isn't a comprehensive account which captures the Tata story in its entirety. And plus, in the last 25 years after liberalization, the Tata Group has grown 25 times. When Ratan Tata took over from GRD, the Tata's revenue was 24,000 crores. And now it's 6,50,000 crores. So that's the kind of growth the Tatas have seen. So I found a great opportunity to contribute a book which covers all of these facets, talks about a way of business which is possible, where you can do well by doing good, and also presents several other facets about India and its evolution. So in the book, along with the Tata story of 15 decades, you'll find the evolution of Indian business, you'll find the evolution of Indian economy, you'll also find the evolution of Indian polity right from the years of the Victorian Raj all the way through Prime Minister Narendra Modi, the entire gamut of years, because business and bureaucracy and business and politics are quite in interaction on several counts. So I had an opportunity to cover all of these as well. So it's all in all a very interesting account of India as a whole, because it's not, because Tatas and India, like GRD said, are quite synonymous. Tatas for India. And hence, you are also talking about India while you are talking about the Tata Group.
Tell us about Jamshedji Tata.
Yes, Jamshedji Tata is often called as the man who saw tomorrow. He's also called the father of Indian industry. Very few people analyze that he lived just 64 years, and of which almost 15 years were spent on sea. And today's generation and the millennials, including me, may think why 15 years on sea? And that is because he visited the eastern and western continents across the seas and wanted to learn the best practices of corporations there and see what can be brought into India and for its well-being. Today, Mr. Chandrasekharan, who is the chairman of Tata's, covers 4 countries in 1 week and comes back. In those years, Jamshedji had to travel 3 months one way to reach America and then 3 months back. But that was the passion of that man, because he wanted to bring the best of the developed worlds into India and empower India with its own industrial success. That was one of the greatest contributions he had as a visionary, because he believed that a strong industry is a precondition for India to emerge as a strong democracy after gaining independence. And for that, we'll need to invest several decades of hard work to make it happen.
So how did a trading company turn into an illustrious industrial group that it is today?
Yeah, it happened in Jamshedji Tata's lifetime. He transformed a trading company predominantly engaged in textiles by diversifying and investing in several other areas, including construction, shipping, hospitality, and leaving behind ideas in steel, education, and power. A very important contribution in that direction was made by his son, Dorabji Tata, who isn't discussed much in business history, but he served as the chairman of Tata Sons for 25 years, which is longer than the tenure of Mr. Ratan Tata. And in very crucial years, because that was the period after the founder left, which is the time when you need someone really strong to hold on to the founder's values and take things forward. And also the period of World War I. Mm-hmm. After which Indian economy really suffered due to a lot of dumping and other industrial issues. But he did diversify into several areas: insurance, banking, cement, invested in aviation, several other areas. So you see, over a period of time, and then JRD built onto that, invested in automobile, chemicals, watchmaking. So you see, every successive chairman over the last 100 years, or over the 100 years from Jamshedji's time, have been contributing to very diverse kind of industry areas where they are entering as businesses. So what started in Jamshedji's time as a trading house and almost became a large industrial group was built on by Dorabji Tata, Navroji Saklatwala, and JRD Tata in the subsequent 100 years. And it became India's largest business house, also India's largest conglomerate in terms of the diversity of industries where they were present.
So who, in your opinion, would be the 3 or 4 most significant leaders of the Tata Group?
I think usually most companies are seen from the lens of their chairman, because he's the tallest leader in the group. And hence, you end up analyzing the Tatas into 4 eras: the Jamshedji Tata era, the Dorabji Tata era, the JRD Tata era, and the Ratan Tata era. Mm-hmm. So these 4 are definitely 4 very distinct individuals who've contributed to the group in their own ways. Jamshedji, as I've already shared what he did. Dorabji, as I shared, played a very important role in transforming his father's dreams in steel and power into reality and started all those other companies and sustained all of them in the tough times post World War I. JRD entered a time when India was about to become politically independent and sustained himself as the chairman for 53 years all through the period when we got economically liberalized. Mm-hmm. And every decade he contributed some very important, contributed to very important industries, as I had shared in my previous response. But he also developed a good rapport with bureaucracy in the years of the License Raj, when the private sector was always looked at from a very suspicious point of view, when the black economy started developing in a substantial measure, when taxation rates were extremely high, in between 62 and 72, the highest tax bracket was 97.5%. And you add to that the wealth tax and you end up paying 105 rupees tax for every 100 rupee you earn. Mm-hmm. So that was the kind of tax system which existed. And in all of this, to very effectively balance social contribution, public relations, government relations, and doing good job with your businesses is a great achievement. In fact, JRD was the one who introduced mandatory CSR into the articles of association of most leading Tata companies in the 1960s, mm-hmm. when it wasn't even required, nor was it thought of, nor was it possible, because you were anyway paying such huge amounts of taxes. So great amount of work, a great statesman, businessman, and the only businessman to be conferred the Bharat Ratna. He was very often called Apudo JRD. Apudo means apna in Gujarati, because people always thought that he is a part of India and a part of their society. And of course, Ratan Tata, the fourth person, the contribution has been in trying to make the group relevant in the post-liberalization era. The Tatas were quite siloed by the time JRD retired. They were quite the old world kind of company, having been around for 125 years. So Ratan Tata did two or three key things. One is trying to bring about this whole feeling of one Tata, that is one group, so that each company learns from the other. There's a cohesive unit, there's a common brand, there's a common logo, there are common practices, the Tata Code of Conduct, the Tata Business Excellence Model. All of these helped in putting the whole ecosystem in one identity. Second focus and contribution was on trying to globalize the group. When the multinationals are coming to India, he felt that we should not only be competitive and improve our performance to match their performance, but also go global and overseas and establish the Indian performance levels overseas. And they did that very well. Tetley, JLR, Chorus, and several others. More successful, some unsuccessful, but definitely today, Tatas are the largest employer in Great Britain. So that's the kind of footprint. And lastly, in terms of innovation and business excellence, these were new age requirements which he brought in. So these four are definitely the key contributors in four different eras. You have other leaders in their own era, Rusi Modi for Tata Steel, Suman Mulgaonkar for Tata Motors. You have Bhaskar Bhatt and Aziz Desai for Titan. You have Mr. Kohli, Mr. Ramadurai for TCS. And now you have a TCS MD like Chandrasekharan become the group chairman. So at each company level, there have been really great contributors. And the chairman have been the real visionary leaders at the top.
So I would like to read an excerpt and then I would go on to my question. In case of the Tata Group, neither the Tata family nor Chairman Ratan Tata appear in the list of India's wealthiest families. And this takes me to my question. TCS could have been listed, you know, during the dot-com phase, but Ratan Tata chose against it.
Right.
And he got it listed only in 2003. Why so?
Yeah, so I'll just cover both points briefly. The first part on why Ratan Tata isn't the richest businessman, though Tatas are the largest group, is because Ratan Tata owns only 0.8% of the Tata Sons, the holding company. So the 100-odd Tata companies are held by Tata Sons to varying degrees. And 67% of the Tata Sons is held by Tata Trusts. And Tata Trusts are mandated to spend 85% of their earnings for social welfare. So you see, the majority ownership of the group is such that the money goes back into the society for their well-being.
And that's been the case with all their leaders.
Yes, right? it's a structure which has been there for, yes, exactly. It's been there for 125 years. It's not introduced now. It's been there from the early 1900s. So that's why the family doesn't own the group. Unlike a Reliance or a Bharti or a Birla, where the major ownership is by the promoter family. Here, that's not the case. In terms of TCS, yes, the whole thing was because in the dot-com boom, the TCS had a valuation of about 97,500 crores. One of the market analysts group had suggested that. And Ratan Tata was a kind of approach that we may consider listing the TCS IPO. But he said that we all recognize that this is a boom. Tomorrow the market may bust. And the kind of investments individual shareholders would have made to acquire a TCS share in the boom period may not give them the kind of returns when the boom no longer exists. And they will hold it against the Tatas that the Tatas did not think of their shareholders while listing the IPO. So he said this is not the right time to go for it. Though if they would have listed the TCS in the IPO, and they would have got a market valuation of 97,500 crores and would have sold 25% of that, they would have been able to take over 100% of ownership of Tata Steel, Motors, Chemicals, Power, which was only 10 or 15% or 20% in those years. So it was working to their business advantage. But I believe they were more keen that the shareholders should not lose out just because their business needs are immediately met. So they kept it and they finally released it, not in 2003, listed it in 2004. Just after the Vajpayee government lost the elections and the stock market crashed by 25%. At the nadir of that period, they listed the TCS IPO. But today, it's India's most value-creating company.
Yes. So, There's a general notion that shareholders of the Tata Group, other than for TCS or Titan, don't happen to make as much money as they ideally should.
That's a point which is often used to say that the Tata model may not be a commercially sustainable model. Yes. It's a gold standard in ethics and social responsibility. And that's why the group has always been seen from that lens. Mm-hmm. They are contributors to IISc, Tata Memorial Cancer Hospital, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, all brilliant social welfare institutions. What about business? And that's why in my book I have captured that the four pillars of economics, land, labor, capital, enterprise, need to get their returns. So you get rent, wages, profits and interest. Mm-hmm. So enterprise has to get its profit to be an economically viable entity. So I analyzed the performance of 16 Tata companies post-liberalization, mm-hmm. from 92 to 2017-18, about 26 years. And I notionally proposed an investment of 1 lakh rupees equally across these 16. And what results we got was that in the same period, a 1 lakh invested in the Nifty or BSE Sensex would have given a return of 10 lakhs. But that much of investment in these 16 Tata companies gave an investment of nearly 40 lakhs, which is 4x of what BSE or Nifty gave. Mm-hmm. In the same period, the Tatas created more wealth for shareholders than what Siemens, Mitsubishi and GE did, the largest conglomerates of Europe, America and Japan. They created more wealth than Reliance and Birla between 2008 and 2018, which was the post-financial crisis period. And the Tatas have created more wealth for their shareholders than even Berkshire Hathaway, which is led by the phenomenal investor Warren Buffett. So this whole notion,
why do you think such is the notion?
Because we are always used to see company success from a quarter to quarter basis. Mm-hmm. When Tata Motors India division was not doing well, the Tatas were hailed for their vision for acquiring JLR. Now JLR has undergone an industry down cycle in that market or in the global markets, but the India operations of Tata Motors are doing well. So people say, oh, but the JLR is now a drag on Tata's resources and the India business is fine. So we always look at who is doing well at a particular point in time. But for such business houses and such kind of a global presence, we have to see their performance in a much larger context of time period. So that's why I've taken a period of 25 years, because there are several cycles going up and down. There are several political changes. There are several globalization and demographic changes. And in that, is the company giving a sustained output, mm-hmm. and creating wealth for shareholders? That is the true measure. And also communication. Yeah. That's another thing. Tatas are a little hesitant on talking about their successes in a very proactive fashion. They're always very humble, very modest. That's been their culture. Actions should speak louder than words. Ethics, morality, these have been their guiding words.
Shashank, alongside several achievements, like innumerable achievements, the Tatas have also had their share of failures, as right. well as they've attracted a couple of controversies over
right.
the years.
Right.
Do you think that they could have, dealt with them any differently, or any way they could have averted these situations?
Yeah. Let me take an example which I had asked Mr. Ratan Tata himself during my interview with him, mm-hmm. which was quite a memorable one. I asked him, what in your opinion has been your greatest success and your greatest failure? Mm-hmm. So he said, my greatest success and my greatest failure both are the Nano. And I asked him why. So he gave a very insightful answer. He said, the Nano has done for Tatas what no other product or service has done for the group in the last 100 years. The kind of visibility, awareness and the capability of Indian corporations and Tata Group as a whole, that it has communicated to the global fraternity, is without a parallel. So that way it is one of the greatest success stories. Greatest failure, he said, because it did not do well as we had anticipated to. And two or three key learnings out of that, which also makes very insightful management research. One, he said, is that in terms of the whole approach of providing people at the base of the pyramid a product which is cheap. People usually, and I'm not quoting him, but I'm trying to just elaborate on what I understood from what he said, and I've covered that in the book as well. Mm-hmm. We usually think that people at the base of the pyramid would be fine with any product we give them, which is a good quality product, but we focus more on the value of the product, the price of the product. Mm-hmm. So we usually think that a cheap product or a dole is what they would be happy with because they don't have anything. But the key learning from nano and the kind of products at the base of the pyramid is that they too have a lot of prestige related requirements. They don't want to be seen as being given a cheap product. They would be happy to take a loan and buy a more expensive product rather than being seen using a cheap product. So that is one key learning for businesses at the base of the pyramid as a whole, that when you are innovating and trying to do research for products at that level, they should be products which add value and which are not perceived as being a cheap product. The second was obviously the communication strategy, which they didn't plan it that way, but it kind of backfired as I see it, that it was picked up by the media and promoted as the cheapest car. Actually, it's one of the most innovative cars. Because the kind of patents, both design and technical patents, number almost 60 to 70, which is again without a parallel in the global industry. It was the car which received the maximum number of advanced full payment orders, 2 lakh orders, even before the car came into the market. So it had some great success for it, but several lessons. And what could have been done differently was maybe the communication strategy.
Yeah, because it took away the aspirational value from the car,
exactly.
Like completely.
Exactly. So communication, I think, is one thing. They are, as I said, a little shy on communicating because, again, they have been men of action and more on the performance side rather than talking even about their success stories, which they have started doing now. So if you see on Twitter, they talk a lot about their historic and current success, which wasn't the case earlier.
Shashank, what have been your key takeaways from this entire project of meeting them, you know, being with them, researching on them, and then writing about them?
Yeah, I think the most interesting learning has been that Indian corporations have come of age. We are no longer an underdog as a country. I often quote this and I'd like to share that here. India is the third largest economy in the world today in terms of purchasing power parity. And the latest Standard Chartered report shows that we'll be number 2 by 2030. China at 64 trillion, India at 45 trillion, and the US at 30 trillion. So within 11 years, we are going to be the second largest economy in the world. And Mr. Adi Godrej put forth an article that by 2050, India will overtake China and become the world's largest economy in terms of purchasing power parity. So we are no longer the underdogs in any field. We are by and large very aspirational. We are no longer an underdeveloped country. We are an emerging nation. And our performance shows that in very substantial measure. There are several things that global corporations can learn from India, given the diversity, given the variety in all ways possible. Industry variety, demographic variety, geographic variety, and how we handle with that, because there is no homogeneous customer base or employee base that you're dealing with. You are dealing with a lot of heterogeneity, and how India has been successfully able to do that. And also been able to go global and achieve the kind of success, whether it's in Africa, Europe, America, Australia, Latin America. Companies up from India have done extremely well. So there is a lot that our peer developing nations in Africa and Latin America can learn from the India success story. So there is a great opportunity for more and more management researchers to learn from what Indian corporations are doing well, where have they failed and how they have turned around, and to share that story for the benefit of the future budding managers, as I said in the beginning. For example, in Harvard, Stanford, INSEAD, MIT kind of universities, there are 100 case studies on different Tata companies, which they are teaching as a part of several courses. That is the kind of interest that exists in international institutions. When I was at Harvard, I myself had an opportunity to sit through some of those case discussions and have read several of those cases, and I've also referred to that research in this book. So there is so much of interest overseas. Why not cultivate that kind of interest and pride in the work that we have done as India? I think that's my greatest takeaway.
Dr. Shah, thank you so much for your time. It was lovely talking to you, and we really, really look forward to your next project. Especially reading your next book.
Thank you. It was wonderful sharing my thoughts, and I wish your program all success.
Thank you so much.